So welcome. This is an ADEMU Pierre Werner Chair lecture. Some of you have been here all day, including Enrique, so you might be exhausted, but we're going to have a very interesting lecture in any case. Most of you know about what ADEMU is. If not, you just have to click into the web page of ADEMU. And this is a Horizon 2020 project on assessing the fiscal and monetary framework of the Eurozone and the Euro. And that could not be more timely, because as we move in our research, also Europe is moving. So we had many activities, a conference and so on, and one has been a sequence of lectures. Bob Lucas gave one of the first ones here. The next one is going to be at Prescott in Barcelona, but today we have Enrique Mendoza. And we are very pleased to have him. For most of you, it doesn't need an introduction because you already had met him during the day and you know about it. But I just wanted to mention a couple of things about Enrique. One, as you may know, he started his career in the IMF after getting the PhD in Western Ontario. And there he met and worked together with Guillermo Calvo. To do international macro, and in particular to be concerned about issues of debt, sovereign debt, and so on, better you be from Latin America. And better you also have been working with Guillermo Calvo, who has been the father of all this generation of people. For many years in Europe, we thought that that was not an issue for Europe, so we were talking of other things. But now, recently, we had to learn a lot about sovereign debt crisis. Fortunately, there had been a lot of work being done about sudden stops, about many things, of which of those Guillermo has been ahead of everyone, and now a new generation, in particular Enrique, has been a leading author. He has an impressive CV. If you look at the ISI web of knowledge, he has an H number of 19, which is very high in economics. Okay, and he has been working on all the kind of issues that we in ADEMU we are interested in general. I think we are all interested, having to do precisely about financial crisis, sovereign debt, international spillovers, and so on. So I'm not going to extend anymore, although looking at his CV, there were a couple of things that sort of worry me a little. One is, has to do with Europe, the other about the United States. With Europe is that one of his latest working papers is called Saving Europe, question mark, the unpleasant arithmetic of fiscal austerity and in integrated economies. And it's not very pleasant news what he has to say about programs of fiscal consolidation in Europe. But maybe today he'll tell us better news on US. But there is something else also find it strange in these times of Trump, that his official title, because after Maryland for many years and so on, now recently moved to Penn, University of Penn, Sylvania, is called Presidential Professor of Economics. So I don't know what the connotation of that is, but I'll leave you with that. Thanks for coming and let you see.
Introduction. I think after that, all I can do is disappoint you, but I'll try my best. Still, fortunately, the news are going to be bad. I think, if anything, they're going to get a little worse. For the presidential thing, so lucky for us and for the president of the university, because Penn, as most private schools in the United States, is an extremely liberal college. So the presidential is in the names of the, well, maybe the name will be bad, but in the first presidents of the United States. So we go, so I'm the third. So what am I, Thomas Jefferson, or So we go to this dinner every year where we're sitting there by name, and it's one of these multidisciplinary projects. So the university has this big funding for this, and one of them is from political scientists, and the other is a philosophist, and we go in. So I'm the presidential professor of economics, and I think I'm, if I remember correctly, either Jefferson or Adams, but I forget. So one of those two. So whoever gets hired last is going to get the honors. Although he should not be named, happens to be a graduate from Penn, so, you know. Wharton is still waiting for some contribution. Okay, so yeah, I want to talk about this issue of the public debt crisis of the United States. And as Ramon mentioned, I started my career talking about financial crisis, working at the IMF. And actually, when I started my career, I was working mostly in the RBC model. So my upbringing is a little strange, you could say, because I actually went to school at Western Ontario, which back then was like a branch of Minnesota. And I did my work with Jeremy Greenwood, who back originally actually is an international macro guy. Maybe you don't know that. But back then was beginning to do the transition into RBC work, but he was still teaching graduate international macro. So I was learning that. I always knew I was going to do international macro, but I figured, you know, to get into the academic market of the U.S. As much later, I learned this lesson from Guillermo Calvo, though inadvertently what I was practicing in life. I had to still kind of focus and get into the academic environment of the U.S. by focusing on the things that the academia in the U.S. was looking at with interest. So he was working on RBC, making the transition from international. I figured maybe a good starting point is to try to connect the dots between international macro and the RBC approach. And that's how I started with my work, which then somewhat inadvertently, too, was the first set of models that were looking at incomplete markets models, which justifies some of what we're talking about this morning. So the one common thread through all this work has always been the concern with the connection of international capital flows and incomplete markets. But anyway, when it comes to this question of the United States, you see, I used to travel a lot to Latin America, as Ramon said. This is a good laboratory for to bring people and economists that focus on these things, to bring them up. And now when problems started to emerge in Europe, then I find myself traveling more to Europe than I was traveling to South America, and going more to conferences in Europe than in South America. And then finding, just like we were doing this morning, this discussion of the credit booms, and I was highlighting to you guys how similar they actually are across countries. I was similar experience that some of the problems I was seeing in Europe didn't look that different from the problems I had seen in Latin America, with all dimensions properly taken. And so today I'm going to talk about this issue, public debt crisis of the United States. And maybe the very first question you will have when someone says something like that, and we're used to thinking about use public debt as a prototypical risk-free asset, we use it in our models, it's the place to go every time when someone asks for an example of a risk-free asset. So how can someone be claiming this? Well, at first, I'm not the first one, but you see there's good reasons to be raising concerns about this issue. And there's a lot of connections with the European situation. And in fact, some of the work I'm going to show you spinned off from this paper that Ramon mentioned related to saving Europe, ? And I'll show you some implications for that in the context of the U.S. Environment. So that's the first question someone will ask is, what is this guy talking about? So here is the point. So if you look at U.S. historical data since the beginning of the Republic, so maybe it's also good to be presidential professor, so if I'm Jefferson, I can go back to all of this. From the Assumption Act of 1790, which is when in the United States the federal public debt was created, all the way to the present. And it's a very nice data set that was put together by Henning Bond's career life study of U.S. public debt. So if you look at that data set and you take a statistical definition of what a debt crisis could be and think of that as the 95th percentile of increases year on year on the federal net debt ratio, what you will find is essentially five episodes. And the five episodes will be the usual suspects that you imagine. It will be the two world wars, it will be the Civil War, the Great Depression, and the Great Recession. Where things start to get interesting and somewhat suspicious is when someone asks you, well, how big is the current episode? with tendency to think that maybe compared to the big things I mentioned would be the smallest, turns out to be that's actually the second largest. And it's the only one, if you look at all these five episodes and you ask the question, what was the pattern of the primary fiscal balance after this peak of the debt was reached, it's the only one in which 6 years later we still have a deficit on the primary fiscal balance. It's the only one. And it's the only one in which we forecast, at least if you believe the Congressional Budget Office, budgets that will be in deficit in the primary balance at least through 2026. So it's very large, and it's also very unprecedented on the pattern of adjustment that we have experienced and that we expect to continue to experience. It's also very different of what typically has happened. So once you look at these peaks on the public debt of the US, you can do standard things, some of which I actually learned at the IMF, to decompose what has happened with the public debt when it came down, to what extent it came down because we did fiscal adjustment, to what extent it came down because of what sometimes we think of as a dividend from growth. That's essentially because we think about the debt as a share of GDP, so GDP growth helps correct that. So I'll show you some numbers for that, but for now, this is just the fact. These persistent primary deficits are also strikingly different from historical evidence. In all other previous high peaks of the US public debt ratio, the reduction has always been partly attributed to an important contribution of primary surpluses. So it's a very different pattern of fiscal adjustment in the aftermath of the debt surge from what we have seen in all these episodes before. Now, it gets much worse, and this is also very relevant for Europe, actually, for most advanced economies in the world, because we have something that we didn't have in these other four episodes of the US fiscal history I'm referring to, and again, I'll show you some pictures for all of these facts, and that we have very large unfunded liabilities created by large entitlement programs, social welfare programs. In the United States, this comes from two sources: unfunded liabilities from the pension and medical plans of the state and local governments. This is very heterogeneous across the US. There are states that are essentially bankrupt, if you look at them fiscally, because of these obligations. Studies that have tried to put them together, like the one I quote there from Lutz and Scheiner, put the total figure about 20% of GDP. There is also the federal entitlements, the unfunded liabilities of Medicare and Social Security. It's about 93 percentage points of GDP. So if the US was put through the IMF test, which is that when you put your public debt number out there, you have to put what is defined as the general government. You have to add to the federal debt all the states and local governments, all the entitlement programs, and all the public enterprises together, and that will give you the general relevant debt ratio, which is, for instance, what the OECD does too, and the European Commission does too. So that number will be something close to 200% of GDP. So the effective US debt ratio, public debt ratio, is a very large number. But I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt. So most of the things I'm going to say today are actually not going to take into account this 110+% of GDP that is this elephant in the room. So here is some pictures just to motivate the talk. So here is the Henning-Bond historical data set from the birth of the Republic and the net federal debt ratio. So here are the five episodes that I identify for you as what I'm defining to be the US debt crisis. And notice I use the word crisis differently from defaults, because in some of these episodes, actually, you could argue there was some default, and Tom Sargent in his work with Hall has making this point. But you're just agnostic, and I said, I mean by debt crisis, these spikes on the debt, these five episodes, they're there marked for you, so you can see also the dimensions, the magnitudes of what we're talking about, and the very large size of the current debt crisis, and where it's headed. So I ended the time series where Henning's end, and then I added the projections from the March 2016 Congressional Budget Office projections that go through 2026. So to give you an idea of just historically, from that perspective, how large the fiscal crisis in the US, or how serious the fiscal situation in the US is at current. So here is, if you take at these dates, the peaks that you see identified there with the arrows, and then you look at the consistent primary balance data that was also constructed by Henning Bonn, dating as date zero each of those peaks in those arrows. So I'm going to show you the evolution of the primary fiscal balance in the years after this fiscal crisis. So here is a picture where I was telling you the differences are unprecedented. So that's the red line that then ends with a dashed line, the dashed line being, again, the projections from the Congressional Budget Office. So here, fiscal solvency is a situation where sign matters because we're talking about balancing the intertemporal budget constraint of the government, and I'll say a lot more about that. So obviously, when the change of sign occurs, it's very important. And that actually it occurs, it's fundamentally important. So what this plot is telling you is what I was showing earlier. In many of these episodes, by 5 years later, you already were in a primary surplus. That's a negative on this chart. So you can see here the contrast, right? So the Great Depression did not have the largest deficits. It was larger deficit than the Great Depression. It was smaller than the wars. But then it has been much slower to come down, and certainly it's not projected to change sign for as far as 2026. So it's a very different pattern of fiscal adjustment from what we've seen before, for whatever reason. Okay, so this is not telling you what exactly changed in policy, or whether it was the growth dividend, or consequences of supply side. No, this is showing you, making a point. Whatever it was, the pattern is very different. And again, this is excluding the unfunded liabilities of the entitlement programs. So how about doing this accounting for the large debt reductions? So here, let's do the following. Let's take, again, the bond data set. Let's take the initial debt ratios for these five episodes and the final ones. So these are the largest debt reductions in the Henning bond data set, the peak and the trough. And of course, they're different length in terms of how many years did it take to bring the debt all the way down to the numbers in the second column. So the third column here is just how much the debt changed. So you have debt reductions as small as 16 percentage points of GDP and as large as 85 percentage points of GDP, which is the debt reduction from the post-World War II period through 1974. So what I'm trying to do here is look at these five different episodes, a lot of heterogeneity and the conditions that led to them and the conditions that led to the recovery. But my point is to illustrate the following. The first thing is that traditional decomposition, again, that I learned in the IMF, and what is widely used, so you see it in Henning's word as well, is to say, well, from the government accounts, you can say that what contributes to a change in the debt ratio to GDP is the accumulated overall government deficits, so including interest, again as a share of GDP, and then something that we like to call the growth effect or the growth dividend, which is there because, again, we're looking at things measured as ratios of GDP, where gamma will be the growth rate of nominal GDP. So what you see here is the decomposition of the change in the debt. So for instance, here, if the debt fell 30 percentage points of GDP in this debt adjustment episode, what this is telling you is 23 percentage points came from the growth dividend, and only 7 came from overall surpluses. So you see a negative here means we have overall cumulative surpluses between this date and this date, owing to that much, or expressed in per year, it's an overall surplus per year of slightly close to 0.5% of GDP. So what Henning and others have concluded from looking at this is saying, it's essentially a growth story. Large reductions of the US debt and nothing to do with overall deficits. It's mostly about getting that growth going. Well, first of all, we might be worried about that growth prospect, and that's also a concern for Europe. Maybe this time is again different because growth prospects look like they're weakening rather than strengthening. But I'm also going to challenge the notion because, again, using the government accounts, you can decompose the primary deficit, the overall deficit, into its two components, which are the primary deficit, the gap between tax revenues and government expenditures, and the net interest payments, so the debt service. So you arrange things that way, and you say, well, now I'm going to put here the cumulative primary deficits, and now the debt service net of the growth effect. And the picture is very different. None of these episodes was accomplished without cumulative primary surpluses. And in fact, the primary surpluses range from about 0.2% of GDP in these episodes to about 3 percentage points of GDP per year. So put this in contrast with what the plot I show you is telling us that the pattern of the US primary balance looks like. Nothing with surpluses for at least up to now and for the next 10 years. So it's very different prospects and a very different pattern from adjustment from whichever of these angles you look at the situation. Okay, but it's not true that the growth doesn't matter. What the growth has done essentially is contribute significantly, in some cases by more than enough, to offset the debt service. So I'm not saying that growth is irrelevant. It is relevant. I'm just saying none of these adjustments happen without the primary balance turning into surplus. And the data says relatively soon, which it hasn't. So just looking at those numbers from this sort of IMF attitude to it, you say, you know, this is starting to look a little bit like my days in El Salvador, I was telling you in the morning, and not what we're used to thinking if we think about the U.S. as a bastion of fiscal sustainability. In the meantime, what we have is a lot of calls for fiscal expansions for a number of very well-intended reasons. And in particular, we have three arguments that are widely put forward. I say, well, we should not worry about the high debt. You know, this is, we need it. So fiscal expansions will be good. We could fight these protracted recessions, this secular stagnation. We could fight deflation. We could build much needed infrastructure. We could try to take advantage of those fiscal multipliers. And I'm going to challenge that notion as well in a minute with some empirical evidence. It's also the second argument that says the world just seems to be starved for these so-called safe assets. It seems that we need more of them, and that's another social benefit of having more public debt out there, not less. And then, of course, if you look at the numbers today for the price of this debt, you will say, what are you talking about? It's a comment we had in the morning. Yields in a lot of these instruments are negative. So it's a good time to borrow. It's a good time to borrow a lot. So it's sort of perplexing. I'm arguing here about fiscal solvency. I'm arguing to you that we should be worried about fiscal solvency when the markets are just gulping this stuff, or at least until fairly recently, with an incredible appetite. Even from the serial defaulters, when Argentina finally came back in the markets, a lot of us were surprised. Not just that they came back to begin with, but just how quickly and at what good prices they entered. So given the history of non-repayment. So I'm going to challenge these notions. I'm going to present for you essentially, my lecture consists of making four arguments to the contrary, and sort of going rather quickly through them, but trying to give you the substance of the four. So here is the first one. What does empirical evidence really say about those fiscal multipliers? What does the empirical evidence say if I'm looking for evidence that that intertemporal global budget constraint holds for the US? So these two related but not similar questions. So the first thing is that if you look at fiscal multipliers under situations of high debt, actually they are zero on impact and negative when you accumulate them. So, and it's similar to some literature from Europe that had been done before by some of the same guys that now push for fiscal expansion. So it's strikingly that when it was about Latin America, this was the way they thought, but when they think about Europe, they think in some other way. So that's one part of the evidence I'm going to document for you. The second is, and this is again another big contribution of Henning Bohn's work, is all kinds of discussions in the empirical literature about how to measure or empirically test whether debt is sustainable. And if by that you mean whether the intertemporal global budget constraint holds, Henning's work initially kept mystifying people, because here there were the unit root guys and the co-integration guys trying to test for these properties to establish whether the debt was sustainable or not. And here comes this guy and first says, well, you know what? All you require is a positive response, actually a sufficient but not necessary condition, is that the response of the primary balance to debt is positive. Doesn't matter if it's more or less to the interest rate, just positive. And a few years later, he comes back and says, and you know what? You don't even need that. You just need the debt to be integrated of any finite order. Okay? So I'm asking you, as macroeconomists, do you guys know a macro time series that's not integrated of like order one, sum at two? Does anyone knows a time series in macro that integrated over the tree? So Henning's work essentially saying, you know what, testing the intertemporal geometry constraint is useless. But fiscal reaction functions are very informative. So these response regressions are informative. And in this particular situation, they're informing us that something is wrong with fiscal adjustment in the US, or something is very different if you don't want to be critical. Not wrong, but different. So I'll walk you through that evidence, but that's the first argument. First argument is empirical evidence that we should worry about fiscal multipliers and that something is wrong with fiscal reaction function. Second is this unpleasant arithmetic. If we do this stuff that we had done in this paper for Europe, but instead of doing it for Europe, which in that paper we had thought about Europe as two regions, you do it for the US and Europe as two countries, what you find is something worrisome. Think about redoing these classic Laffer curve exercises, but doing it in a dynamic general equilibrium model. So asking the question, how much the present discounted value of the primary fiscal balance changes when you change taxes? And then inject into this model the observed increases in debt, and then ask, can we change taxes so that these Laffer curves pay for that? And the answer is no. So I'll come back to that. But that's the second point. Comes from this structural, if you want. The first one is non-structural empirical evidence. The second one is the structural implications of this, in many respects, fairly neoclassical, fairly standard dynamic general equilibrium model. Also, these international spillovers are large, so there's no wonder we had all the arguments that we first saw in Europe with tax competition, and we started seeing in the US with a strong fury over the tax inversions. The international spillovers, so these changes in capital income taxation in particular, these models predict are very large and justify why governments, doesn't make them good or bad, but justify why governments have strong incentives to behave the way they do with respect to capital income taxation. And this notion about the demand for risk-free assets. So I find it very unsettling that we try to pin down the notion of how sustainable the debt that the US has is on the notion of something that we don't understand well. So I'm not going to deny there's a lot of appetite for risk-free assets. But the academic literature has been struggling for understanding why. It's a very nice area for research, a lot of fun to work on some of this stuff. And I did some papers with Victor Rios and Vincenzo Quadrini that I'm going to refer to for this point. So it's a lot of fun for research, but still a lot of debate as to why we have such strong demand. And then it becomes a critical issue whether that strong demand is a transitional phenomenon or is a permanent phenomenon. And whether it's a symptom of stability and efficiency, or it's a symptom of potential instability and or an inefficiency. Because then we have to worry if we're pinning down the sustainability of a very large debt stock on something that we should A, not take as given as a permanent thing, or B, not be doing in the first place. So that's what the third point will be, this debt demand instability argument, as I call it. So in particular, I'll show you that what we had argued in these papers with Victor and Vincenzo is that financial integration across countries that are on different degrees of financial development may produce this very strong demand for risk-free assets as a result of transitional dynamics that are very slow-moving, just like Francesca was showing you in the session this afternoon. So these things may take a long time, but they settle. And when they settle, if we continue in this fiscal path, it's going to be a day of reckoning from the perspective of these models. Another alternative is also financial integration, even if countries are all of the same degree of financial development, but different in their financing needs, on their sustainable debt in the traditional sense. So the annuity value, the primary fiscal balance that the agents perceive is higher in one region than another, it's another reason why you may see similar transition dynamics. And then finally, I'm going to say that on account of 1, 2, and 3, maybe we should worry about these assets being risk-free assets. And history tells us that countries have defaulted on their domestic public debt obligations, much less so than an external debt. External debt is relatively rare, right? So it's about 6-7% frequency. And the data that, say, Reinhardt and Rogoff have looked at for a couple of hundred years says that the frequency of these outright defaults on domestic bondholders is about 1 to 3. So for every 3 external defaults, you have one of these domestic ones. But you do have these domestic ones. And even in the United States, so that's where Sargent and Hall come in. So they do a magnificent job of illustrating all the kinds of default mechanisms that the US government exploited early in its history to default on both its external as well as its domestic government bondholders. And make no mistake, reconstructions of entitlement programs are defaults. But here I'm talking in the data set that these two sets of authors look at outright defaults on contracted government debt obligations, like forced extensions of maturities, forced conversions of one type of debt for another. All those things that we might not want to think of as defaults are defaults. Inflation, so traditionally in the literature on nominal debt, we have worried about inflation as a kind of partial de facto default. But in this particular historical episode I'm mentioning, we're looking at outright de jure defaults on contracted payment obligations. So if that's the case, then it's a question, because it's a phenomenon that we have documented historically, but we don't really understand well. Why will there be optimal to default on domestic bondholders? Easy answer may be to say there is no discrimination. So if all the bonds are issued the same, the fact that some is external, once you're tempted enough to issue on the external, you may say, well, maybe I just want to default on the domestic. That's a story that works well for Argentina, for Mexico, where I am from, because this is kind of the way it happens. But in the US debt markets, the damage of defaulting on the nominal debt instrument at the short end of the yield curve is very heavy, because it's the vehicle for precautionary saving. We spend a good chunk of the study of the day studying. It's the vehicle for liquidity, it's the vehicle for resharing. So I'm going to argue at the very end, and depends on how much time I have at that point, to say that that's the reason why these defaults are very rare. So I can construct a theory of why it will be optimal to default, because there is a temptation to do it for distributional purposes, but on the other hand, the costs are very hefty. But at equilibrium, what you will get is exactly that, infrequent domestic sovereign defaults. I have some exercise calibrated to Spain if you want to discuss that more. Depends on how much time I have. So we'll see where I am when I've done the other three. So multipliers. So let me go quickly to this part, because it's the simplest, easiest one. Just to document, it's a nice paper by Menzi Chin that is a survey of the empirical literature on US fiscal multipliers. And like everything we do in empirical macroeconomics, the numbers are all over the bloody place. And it's almost lined up by political affiliations, what economists seem to find, from almost 0 to 2.5. So depending on the method of estimation, depending on the type of expenditure or tax that we're looking at, the measures go all over the place. But what is not very often done in the literature is what are the fiscal multipliers at different debt levels, or whether different at different debt levels. So we did a kind of work in this cross-country study with Ilseski and Charlie Beck a few years back, which we look at a sample of countries, both industrial and emerging, and then we examine how multipliers change at different debt ratios, among other things. But here is the point for the debt ratios, is that when debt exceeds 60% of GDP, expenditure multiplier is statistically not different from zero. And on impact, that's the case. If you cumulate over the long run, the impact is negative on output, -3. So, not significant on impact, and negative as you accumulate. And when we were doing this, and it's also describing Chin this way, because we talked about this with him, it reminds us of something we had seen in the 90s when we were at the IMF, Charlie Beck and I, that back then, it was the opposite situation that was trying to be justified by something similar. They say, well, what happens is that we have this phenomenon of so-called expansionary austerity. And the idea there is that if you do austerity policies when you have high debt, this can actually have a positive multiplier. Why? Because you create expectations that the country will be solvent and that taxes in the future will be lower. And that will have a feedback effect that will make it easier to do adjustment in the present. So it's the same argument. I'm using is the opposite of that. The reason why the multipliers tend to be negative for these high debt countries, precisely the same kind of expectations, but working on the symmetric case where you are in the opposite situation. So the expectation that the countries will have to adjust abruptly because they have very high debt levels, and if they try to repay, they're going to need higher revenues, is what's going to produce the recessive impact. It's one theory. You know, the bullet from my paper with Charlie and Ethan is an empirical result. But I give you an interpretation that comes from a previous literature on the so-called expansionary austerity, which one of the main contributors was Olivier, who then since then has changed his mind about the merits of austerity. Well, it's an interesting point of view. But be that as it may, the main observation from this slide is we should not be counting on fiscal multipliers to come to the rescue. Or first, we should make a strong case that they remain positive. Back when the US debt ratio was 45%, in 2008, it was probably not a bad idea to try to bank on some kind of fiscal multiplier to come assist. But given the numbers where we are today, maybe we should worry about this. Sustainability. So this is a fiscal reaction function that Henning Bond proposed that I mentioned earlier. So if you run this regression, primary balance on the lagged public debt ratio, everything as ratios of GDP, and these are other drivers of the primary balance. So here you could have your barrel-style temporary shocks to government spending. You could have the single component of GDP. So you want to allow for things that will try to have a larger deficit when things are bad, and that the regressions will pick them up. But Henning's point was it is sufficient for this raw to be positive for the intertemporal budget constraint of the government to hold. Even weird stuff can happen. If raw is greater than the interest rate on the debt, the process will be A, consistent with solvency, with the budget constraint intertemporally, and B, stationary. Those two things, he discovered, are not the same. In particular, when the response coefficient is positive but less than the interest rate, something funny happens. The budget constraint of the government holds intertemporally, but the debt explodes. It just doesn't explode fast enough to violate the no Ponzi game condition. So when I told it to my friend at the IMF, I almost got kicked out because I said, you know what? The debt can be sustainable if what you worry about is just intertemporal budget constraint. And may still explode. So we went to the whiteboard and went on this until I convinced them that arithmetically this is possible. But this is all Henning's work. Now, so that's what I say. So what you convince with after reading most of his work is that after you find out that all you need is the debt ratio to be integrated of any finite order, you say, I stop caring about whether this condition holds. I care about the dynamics of the debt, but not because of the intertemporal budget constraint necessarily, because I know that rejecting that on past data is impossible almost. But understanding what this means for fiscal adjustment is important. In particular, at this point, if you lower this raw, the intertemporal budget constraint of the government holds, it means it goes back to the same initial debt, but the pattern of the primary balance is different over time. The distribution of surpluses and deficits is different over time. So the long-run debt is very different. So different values of raw will be consistent with the same initial debt at the intertemporal budget constraint, but they all have different time profiles of surpluses and deficits and different long-run deficits. Different long-run debt ratios. So I'll show you some numbers here. So we did some of this work in a paper for the macro annual that came just last year. And we say, okay, if you extend this work to a sample of advanced and industrial economies, what we find is like Bond, we cannot reject by and large that this coefficient is statistically positive. But we find a large structural change in 2008, statistically significant, that shows you, again, evidence consistent with the suggestive pictures I showed you at the beginning. The fiscal stance of the United States has changed dramatically. In particular, you have a lower response, large residuals, and predicted primary deficits much larger than what these regressions would predict. So the fiscal reaction function for whatever it's supposed to represent has changed dramatically. In particular, you can make this point, the deficits are much larger than the out-of-sample pre-2008 forecast. And remember, this mu allows for having had a deeper recession or wanting to spend more. So even after that, still too much. So here is the point. So here is just a collection of the results, but you don't need to focus on all of them. There's too many on this slide. So here is first what Henning Bond had obtained in his last paper using this data set for this period. This is what we redo if we use the entire data set. So you can see basically the same result. Now, Sorry, this is what 2008, right? So this is what happens if you end the regression at 2008. So the point here was to say, if we add a few more years from the end of Henning Bond's last regression, 2008, no worries, you get the same result. What you see here in the first column is what happens if you estimate the model through 2014. Then the coefficient falls to about 0.08, and this is like Irving Fisher's magic of compound interest. So the difference between 0.10 and 0.08 means a lot, and I'll show you why. And moreover, you can do a structural test and find that this is a statistically significant structural change on the fiscal reaction function. Both of them are consistent with solvency, so out of this I cannot reject the solvency condition. But I can again characterize that this is a very different monster because we have also done these kind of things from before and not found much of this structural difference. Some, but not much. So here is, if you use the regression that is in 2008, and you project, you feed it with the observed government expenditures and with the observed recession through 2014, 15, I think, and then feed it with the projections on the president's budget for the years after that. So you can see what the 2008 regression we have predicted would have been the path of the primary balance through 2020, I think is when we ended here. And these are the standard error bands. And this is where the actual data is, and then after 2014, the projections in the president's budget. So this is not just like, it's a little change and you have some larger deficits because of some slightly larger residuals. It's a radical departure from whatever the fiscal reaction function was before. So it's almost like the projections for the president's budget look at our paper and say, we better just kind of like stay just at the standard error band, no? It's like a coincidence, just how well it tracks, but that's weird. But yeah, so the large distance between this blue line and this red line tells you the deficits have been much larger, even after you allow this fiscal reaction function to account for the deeper recession and the larger expenditure. Now, this is what happens if you take the fiscal reaction function and then you use the baseline estimate. So the debt ratio should be mean reverted going back to the long run average. It will take, again, very long, okay? So this is like the year, 2100, I think. And then this is what happens when you lower the response coefficient to half. And you can see it almost tracks better the observed evolution of the debt in the short run. But then, of course, you're going to end up with a much higher long run debt ratio, which, of course, means that the primary surplus that the economy must be expecting is larger. Okay, so that's all fine, but it doesn't tell you much. Okay, so again, Henning and others, out of this empirical literature, what conclude is don't get interested in this because of testing fiscal solvency. Get interested because we want to look at these patterns of what predicted fiscal adjustment looks like. But the limitation is structurally, you can't say much. I cannot say much in terms of welfare as to whether this is better or worse and by how much than the alternatives. For that, I need a more structural model. The simplest one to start with that we thought of was the dynamic neoclassical model with exogenous balance growth, the workhorse typical model that we had, say, in the background, or the RBC model. What we do is to recognize one important thing, and we have done, and that model has been used in the literature for a whole array of experiments on optimal taxation, whole literature in the 1990s on optimal taxation based on the same line of models. One thing, and in those models, if you remember correctly, well, it's time inconsistency, because taxing capital at the beginning, because it's inelastic, and all those arguments. But the important thing is, we had not stopped, at least in a lot of the literature, to look at the empirical evidence on what the elasticity of tax bases is. And the canonical neoclassical model gives you not just an underestimate of the capital tax elasticity, it gives you the wrong sign. So when we started here, we say the first thing we want to do is plug this hole. We want something that's going to look very workhorse-like two-country neoclassical model, but we're going to introduce a mechanism to match and calibrate the observed elasticity of the capital tax. And there are many ways to do it, and the simplest one we could think of was endogenous utilization of capital. We say what governments tax is revenue from capital. So if you jack up the capital taxes a lot, firms are not going to stay there silly and let you tax their effective capital. What they're going to do is reduce the utilization and generate less capital income. And that's going to make a response of the capital tax base reflect what we see in the actual data. Okay, so it's a collection of stuff, like Ramon mentioned, that comes from another paper. I don't know, it's a lot of interesting details, but the important part is this. We want to discipline the model, calibrate a lot of dimensions that are very RBC-ish-like, except for this important one. We want to match the estimated tax elasticities for the capital tax. And we do this in two things, mainly with this endogenous utilization, and also because while tax systems provide credits for depreciation, we have to be careful that residential and non-residential investment are treated very differently. And in particular, the explicit statutory deduction applies to the resident, to the non-residential, and mostly the corporate capital. So we have to treat that carefully, and that's what we mean by limited depreciation tax allowance. And there are other details, but mostly as you go through the list here, it's a very plain vanilla, neoclassical two-country model, except for the fact that we introduce these mechanisms so that the calibrated elasticity of the capital tax base can match empirical estimates. Now, why two countries? Because we wanted to capture that in today's world of integrated capital markets, taxing capital is also hard because of the international spillovers. If I become the internationally disadvantaged country in taxing capital, capital leaves. And that makes it even harder to extract revenue from capital. And that's the experience that Europe had with the round of capital tax competition that led this literature on the so-called race to the bottom. So we have a model that has all these blows and whistles. And I don't want to spend these interesting details, but at the pace that I'm going, I'm going to skip a lot of the details. But this one is important. So here is my intertemporal budget constraint. So suppose that you did that. You have this two-country, neoclassical model with all these blows and whistles, exogenous balance growth, so the long-run growth rate is not affected by these tax changes. And it has a tax on capital, a tax on labor, a tax on consumption, government expenditures, entitlements, all this stuff calibrated to the data. One country is the US, the other is an aggregate of Europe weighted by GDP. And what I put here are the government budget constraints, the period by period one. So here is the revenue from all the sources of taxation. You can see here my depreciation allowance to a fraction theta of the capital stock. Here are the total expenses on government expenditures and entitlements. Here is the other side of the equation, the debt, again, it's in shares of GDP, the price of the debt, which is QG. It's a general equilibrium model. So everything that you see here that has to do with a price or an allocation will be computed in the two-country equilibrium model. So my point here is this. When I was thinking about Laffer curves earlier, think about the right-hand side here. This is the part that the fiscal reaction function cannot do for us. Okay? So here is the present discounted value of a particular stream of primary balances as a share of GDP along the equilibrium path. It's a perfect foresight model, like a lot of the work on optimal taxation using these models of the 90s. So everything is in shares of GDP. So you can see here my growth dividend. So when I discount the future primary balances, I'm discounted by the interest rate, which is the reciprocal of the price. I'm discounting by long-run growth, so I'm going to get my growth dividend. And I'm discounted by transitional growth, which is this psi. And also, it's an equilibrium price, and also the equilibrium allocations of consumption, labor, capital, utilization rate, which is M, and the equilibrium prices of the factors of production. So here is what we ask the model to do. We say, okay, we calibrate the model to pre-crisis numbers, and then we say, suppose that you change one of these tax rates. It's a two-country model, so there is a set of equations for the other country as well. And the prices have to be world equilibrium prices for everything that's traded worldwide. So then we ask, okay, suppose that you change each of these tax rates, how much does this change? Right? Because if that's what we define sustainable debt to mean, by how much this change is by how much the sustainable debt change. So that we're going to call the dynamic Laffer curve. Travan and Hewley have a very similar paper. But again, it was on the class of models where we didn't look at the actual tax-based elasticity. So if some of you guys have looked at the paper, say, but these guys already did that. And in their case, the dynamic Laffer curve is an upward sloping, almost endless curve that looks like you can tax capital forever, no problem. So here is what happens when you do that here. So let me skip all of this. So this was just to characterize the tax wages and the tax competition. But let's skip this. So again, remember, in this world, you will beggar thy neighbor if you lower your capital tax and the other country is silly enough to stay with a high tax, because the capital will move to your country. So the other country will lose tax revenue and you will gain some by lowering your tax. of course, strategically, they might not want to do that. So we calibrated the model, and here you can see the differences between Europe and the US in tax rates, government expenditures, the differences in total expenditures and revenues. So the gap in those tell you the important differences in entitlements, for sure. And this is how much the debt changed from prior to crisis to after crisis. So all these numbers are important to characterize the differences. So here is the pictures. Let me advance to the numbers here. So here is the Laffer curve for the capital gain, capital tax rate for the United States. This is where the debt is today relative to pre-crisis. So it went up by 31 percentage points of GDP. So everything here is relative to the pre-crisis steady state. So here is the pre-crisis tax rate, or the calibrated tax rate. So it's, by construction, the zero line. This dotted line will be the Laffer curve if we solve the model as a closed economy, the dynamic Laffer curve, the present discounted value of the primary fiscal balance. And this is the open economy one. So you can see there's no way you're going to cross this with either one of these two. Now, of course, you can get a lot more debt if you move to a closed economy, because if you are increasing your tax rate as an open economy, you're losing, you're becoming the tax disadvantage country. So this is really bad news. It looks like tax austerity isn't going to cut it for this, capital tax austerity. Europe, so Europe is on the wrong side of the Laffer curve. So it taxes capital so much that it's over here. What it should do is cut its tax rate. As a closed economy, forget it, it's also always under the required revenues. As an open economy, it could move over here, cut its capital tax rate to 16%, but only because it's begging its neighbor. So if the United States is silly enough to stay with a 33% effective capital tax rate, and Europe can halve it to 16%, then it will be good days. But that's just banking on the stupidity of tax authorities. Or maybe that's a good way to bank. Okay, so let me skip that. So let me just make these last 2 points, because I'm not going to have time to do the sovereign default. So this one is about financial integration. So I want to make this because, again, the easy response to what I'm saying would be to say, look, guy, why worry about these first two arguments? Price of the debts are skyrocketing, yields are negative, times are good, go home, don't talk about this. So again, as I was saying earlier, we don't really understand where this high demand is coming. So some of the papers that try to make progress in this is like the work we did with Victor and Vincenzo. So here is the first argument of that paper. If you take countries that are heterogeneous on their initial financial conditions, and you put them together on a global capital market, it's like international macroeconomics got turned upside down. And the countries that we thought should be getting the money are the countries sending the money out. And the countries that we thought would be sending the money out are the countries that are borrowing. So here is the argument, and this is good for what we did in the morning, because it's exactly the plot that I was telling you in the morning. So this will be the demand of debt that I showed you in the morning from the precautionary savings story. How close this is to the red line is a measure of your financial development. Countries with curves that are positionally higher are more financially developed. Countries that are lower and lower are less financially developed. And think of this as the annuity value of the primary fiscal balance. So this is a supply of public debt. This is another of Rao Yagari's setups, okay? This is where I borrow this picture from. So this will be the interest rate on public debt, and this is the total equilibrium amount of public debt in the closed economy. Now, someone asked me a question this morning that was great because it gave me a preamble to this. So turn this into a two-country model. The first argument I want to make is suppose that the countries have the same fiscal sustainability condition, but differ on this. So exactly what I was writing on that board in the morning is, here is the US, more financially developed. Here is China, less financially developed. When they were in autarky, this would have been the US risk-free rate. This would be China's effective cost of borrowing, which I wouldn't call the risk-free rate for private agents. And now let's put them to work together. So if you put the global capital market instead of domestic capital markets, then what one country supplies must be what the other rest of the world demands. So in this world, for the United States, yes, yields should drop, and a lot. And the United States should become a net borrower with a negative net foreign asset position, and its debt ratio should rise. So financial integration of countries that are heterogeneous in conditions of financial development, even if they have the same fiscal authorities, could produce this outcome. The important thing for us is that it's a transitional outcome. At some point, you converge, which is what we calculated in our set of the transitional dynamics of this. It's a very long process. You know, calculations takes about 40 years, but it's a process that ends. You can do the alternative, which is to say, no, suppose that this is more like the US versus Europe. Maybe all the countries have the same degree of financial development, but perhaps some have more fiscal needs than others. Then again, financial integration is going to mean a change from autarky rates and autarky amounts of public debt to this equilibrium where the R star is, in which again, countries that will look like the US will become a net borrower and will be issuing more debt and at a lower rate. So again, you have an argument here that says, and this is a transitional argument, there will be a lot of appetite for the risk-free asset, there will be low yields, there will be large US current account deficits, there will be a lot of government debt of the US being issued, but it's not a forever thing. Okay, and that's, let me just say one last word about this since I won't have time to show you. The argument here is what I was suggesting earlier. These defaults, domestic defaults on the debt, if you buy my three previous arguments, or at least some of it, you say maybe, you know, and the discussions on the public debt limit. So the US Congress shoots itself in the foot every now and then by forcing it to discuss whether it will raise the US debt ceiling. So all these discussions, maybe you say, you know, the chances that probability of default in the United States is exactly zero, maybe it's something close to zero, but it's not zero. And in the theory of finance, once the risk-free asset is not really risk-free, things change. So here the point that I want to make is that you can put some structure into this. And as I said, I won't have time to give you to the structure. But here is the argument. That suppose that we take the same principle of the external default models, that the default is strategic, is optimal in a sense. Here is the sovereign that issued the debt. And is looking at its payoff if it defaults and its payoff if it repays. And it will default when it's optimal and only when it's optimal not to do so. So it's not an issue of lack of capacity to repay. It's lack of willingness. But where things have to change, and I think it's very important that what happened in Europe to kind of shake the ground of sovereign default theory, to focus on these domestic defaults, because in some dimension, not completely, but what happened in Europe is more like a domestic default than an external default. So if you think about this situation, you say, well, okay, how can I think about this? This is the way in which using the standard default models isn't going to work, because the creditors are these guys that are out there. The majority of these models are risk-neutral guys. They made a killing while the party lasted. When it lasted, they're going to whine like crazy because they want to be repaid. And if the country gets bailed out, they do get some repayment. So they're still going to whine. But it is kind of like a tears of a crocodile kind of thing. And the creditor in particular knows that the borrower doesn't care. And the borrower truly doesn't care about the lender. And that's the game. In domestic defaults, think about the government cares about all its creditors. The domestic ones are part of the payoff function of the government. So now the question is, would the government that cares about all its citizens, the ones that own the debt and the ones that do not own the debt, still find it optimal to default? Well, it needs to trade off. The benefit of default is, at the moment that you default, you're going to redistribute from the debt holders to the non-debt holders. And if there is enough of these non-debt holders, because there's a lot of relatively unwealthy individuals, you may be tempted to do that. But that's not enough, because in a repeated game, if we thought that's what the government was going to do, we will never buy the debt. There has to be some stochasticity, otherwise redistribution will not support the existence of domestic debt, and there has to be some punishment. And in domestic, and if you read the sovereign default literature, always look for where the people put actually in the paper or in the small footnote, the stuff about default costs. Sovereign default models typically are plagued with strange assumptions about what default costs are, where they came from. But in this case, something very endogenous and very obvious that the public debt is an instrument for liquidity. It's how individuals that are borrowing constrained get some relief from their borrowing. Is the instrument for self-insurance. The guys that are relatively wealthy build these buffer stocks that we were talking about this morning, these precautionary savings, using this instrument. And it's a mechanism of risk sharing. across individuals. If markets are sufficiently incomplete, the public debt is, to its limit, a way of cross-sectional distribution of risk across agents that are drawing different income realizations. There are better ways to do that. So I'm saying it's not a theory here for your everyday debt pricing. It's when you have exhausted all other mechanisms for social redistribution and for provision of liquidity and so on, that these concerns become important. And at that point, you can say, yes, these costs are large, but if I have sufficiently large debt and sufficient inequality, those costs, in a calibrated model with the Spanish data, can outweigh the benefits of repayment. And if that happens, the government defaults. And what you find in a simulated time series for the case of Spain is actually infrequent defaults, more infrequent than in the Spanish data, which is already low, but we get about 0.5% probability of default, and very large debt ratios. So the debt ratios at which domestic defaults occur are much larger than the external default debt ratios. So you get somewhere that tells you there's a reason maybe why we don't see a lot of these defaults. We do see them, though, domestic, external, sovereign defaults. All right, so that's, I'm going to put you through all of this. I already kind of went through it. So you can put this in the context of the models we're talking about this morning, kind of a Bewley-type model, and put the blows and whistles on it to put it to the data and to try to bring it seriously to tell you something about data. But the argument or the gist of the intuition is what I show you. So I will stop at this point so we can have questions and discuss more any of these ideas. I'll be happy.
We have plenty of time for questions. Let's do a round of questions. We collect a few and then let Professor Mendoza answer to them.
So maybe I can ask you one. You guys are going to call your traders. So if I convince you of anything, you'll be calling your traders. I'm just joking. Sorry, yeah, go ahead.
Just regarding this issue of how the magnitude of the schematic lies when there is high debt. I mean, there is this paper by Born, Müller, Pfeiffer, with the cross-country panel bar, I think, and they find that the output cost of a government consumption cut is actually higher during periods of fiscal stress.
Okay, so there is another way of slicing the data. We're looking at whether you have situations. So there is two characteristics in there, right? So there is one about the high versus the low debt, and the other is whether you have a situation of output stress that was high or low. So it's an addition in terms of just explaining purely mechanically the difference. We're not looking at whether the situation was of output stress or not. We're just saying in the entire panel, you just condition on debt being high. This is the implication. Yeah, those things are related, but they're not the same, no? I mean, high debt ratio is a high debt ratio. Spreads can be high at different debt ratios, right? So you think typical emerging markets, for example, on average, even though they default a lot, it'd be interesting to know, on average, the debt ratios are much lower. So for this kind of panel, actually, a lot of the countries that we have, at the end, when we condition for that, are relatively advanced economies, because on average, they can take much higher debt. We do have some of the emerging markets, but so spreads on the debt can be high. So that's what I'm saying, even if debt ratios are not very high. So that's the contrast mechanically, again, in terms of explaining the contrast between the two. There's not many papers in the literature where it's simply conditioned by the size of the ratio. And part is because you need to go cross country, right? Because if you just look at one country, you're just going to have a few episodes, like even in the US data set I showed you, you will have five, essentially. So then you go back to like a Barros identification criterion, which is government spending measured by wars, and then you're left with two episodes. So it's about to be made happy because we're going to have a third one with the big military expansion that the US is planning. But up to now, you only had World War II and the Korean War. Right? And, that's not a lot for identification. Yes. Yeah, they have been playing tricks on all day, so.
Data on fiscal multipliers, do they include Japan? Meaning it's not just, in the case of Japan, it's not just over 60%, it's over 200%, and it seems to be going on forever, and you have Abenomics. Does it mean that Abenomics, if it works, works through some different channel unrelated to fiscal multipliers?
Yeah, so the second question is beyond my pay scale too, as I mentioned this morning for some tricky question, but the first question, the answer is yes. The data set does include Japan. Not a lot of things specific that I can tell you about Japan. Some of the work we have done, like in the part where I was showing you the fiscal reaction functions, if you do them country by country, Japan fails it, meaning the response coefficient, a point estimate is positive, but it's not statistically significant. So the estimates I show you were the panel estimates, but you do it country by country, Japan fails it. Italy is borderline. Forget if Belgium fails it too. And so there's a few cases that fail it if you go country by country. So it's not true just because, but again, it's just a sufficiency condition. So the point I made earlier stands. If you only care to answer the question, can I reject the hypothesis in Japanese data that the intertemporal budget constraint holds? The answer is no, you can't, because the Japanese debt ratio is integrated of finite orders. Now, that's why I say, well, that's totally stupid, because Japan is in so much trouble. That why do I care then if its budget constraint holds or not? Right? Okay, so let me answer a couple of questions about that point. So one thing is important to remember, precautionary savings, maybe I should have mentioned this in the class. Hey, your professor wasn't doing a good job in this dimension. Precautionary saving is a distortion, right? So it's suboptimal. So what it does on the capital side is causes countries to accumulate too much capital, right? So there was a paper that Yagari also had making the case that the optimal tax on capital is actually positive, because you have this distortion on the capital tax. So you can extend this to this two-country thing, and it will leave you in the direction that you're pointing. Now, the question at the end, if you look at what I was suggesting earlier, is like saying, as long as I have integrated capital markets, taxation of capital is plagued by this international strategic interaction, where each one of the players is, say, is because it's not acting as a global planner, saying, let's just screw the other guy. That's why the Irish were doing this to the rest of Europe and cutting its corporate tax rates like crazy, while the others were for a time complaining and then started to catch up. And this is the US tax inversion story again, as you can complain about it, but eventually you say, well, okay, maybe I put some more wedges on the capital markets, or then I have to do something with my corporate tax, otherwise these monies aren't coming back. So the answer could be, if you are going to stick with that, to have some kind of wedge on the returns on capital. That would not be my preferable. I think consumption tax is the less distorting of all of them. But distribution, it has the implication that effectively means putting more of the burden of the adjustment on labor. And you see, the US is funny, no? Because it resists consumption taxation, at least in political terms. It's incredibly what they do. But now this discussion about the export-import tax, what we'll effectively do is exactly that. So it's going to put the burden on labor. It's funny, no?
So thanks for very interesting lecture. Let me ask you a question. Gentlemen. Two questions which are related. You keep talking about optimal default. Whether you call it just debt restructuring, it sounds much better. Then, even then, all what you said about how bad the multipliers are with high debt, what do we know
Okay, that's good questions. So these things, maybe it's something we should all pitch in and try to develop some thoughts. I'm trying to pass the buck here. So it's an interesting question. So let's consider this issue. The restructuring is a good name because like, we get into so much trouble for talking about optimal default, particularly in spheres where they don't, they're happy to hear the word restructuring, they're not so happy to hear the word default. So, and the optimal amount of it. So here is, it's like thinking about it as an optimal policy problem. You want to think about these problems in as an unrestricted set of instruments as possible. And it is indeed the truth that when you think about this issue of default, we always kind of think about it as if it not necessarily is a part of the optimal policy. Maybe as an optimal policy problem, if what you are stuck with is issuing not state contingent debt, that part of the optimal policy should be a combination of the use of this other type of typical tax instruments and default or restructuring. As a way to give yourself a state contingency, if you want to use crude intuition, a state contingency that the contracts do not have. So, because at the end, the argument in the environment that we have works like this. You have these guys that are the owners of the debt. So when you're going to repay, you're going to redistribute depending on how much of the debt they have. And then you're going to punish those that don't because everybody has to pay taxes to pay the debt. So at that point, it's like society's engineering a redistribution that is not lined up with the good and bad luck that agents are experiencing. That's why exposed at that point is where the government says, well, look, if you give me the chance to default, that's like exposed giving me a state contingency that if I could, I will exploit optimally because it will make sense at that point to do so. Now, of course, the challenge technically was to show that if that was ever possible, that people would want to buy into the public debt ex ante. So now that raises the question, say, if I know that I can issue this public debt, but that I don't have commitment, because I know that I might default on this debt, what's the optimal use of public debt as an instrument for financing? So there is an alternative. There's a competing literature of the kind of models that I showed that that's kind of the question. Instead of saying the question, what's the optimal default, what they're asking is, what's the optimal issuance of public debt? In models where the benefits are similar to the ones I showed, that is liquidity and so on, but where you acknowledge that you don't have commitment. So what we're saying is that the government has to optimally choose to default, and the other will be ones that you acknowledge that you have the inability to commit, what would be the optimal amount of debt to issue to begin with? So they're related questions, they're not framed the same way. Maybe we get a lot of pushback on our argument because we put it in this framework that you are going to default. Now, if you ask me what these countries are going to do, so I think in the United States, at least, you start having these discussions about increasing the retirement age, about making Medicare merit eligible or need eligible, all these kinds of things. So everything that is not a public debt instrument issued under law with a contract that says ABCD, but is still a public obligation, the government can default on this gray zone where it can claim it isn't actually defaulting because it never really violated the contract. Now, society will say, you violated the implicit contract because you're making me work until 70 instead of 65, or you're going to make me not be eligible for Medicare even though I'm very wealthy. And that's not what you promised the guys that came before me. So from an economic point of view, in a model like this, since we don't put the contracts in, you will say, that's a default. But technically, the government said, no, that's not a default because the contracts for that didn't exist. There's no paper that you and I have that say, in the US, I will get Medicare even if I happen to be very wealthy, which is the policy today. So this is a weird area. So I think a little bit of inflation helps. And maybe in Europe, we're thinking this is good because we also want to fight deflation. So maybe it's reasons to think. In the US, also because a lot of the debts are dollar denominated everywhere, and a lot of other countries have dollar debts and dollar and US treasuries. A little bit of devaluation helps. In the short run, things are moving in the wrong direction vis-a-vis that. But there are mechanisms that you might not see a day where the US government comes and says, we're defaulting. It's not going to look like Argentina. But what I try to show you is that standard tax adjustment is not going to do it. You could have cuts in the entitlement, so you could say, well, OK, instead of defaulting, let's just reduce benefits. that could help. We didn't try that. We gave it the strongest case where we say we keep the G at the level of share of output that it is today and the entitlements at the share of output that it is today. And then we did experiments I show you. But the message from those sources is the standard fiscal adjustment, and that's what the data is already saying. That's why I started with those numbers. The data is already telling us standard fiscal adjustment. So I don't know exactly which way it's going to end, but standard fiscal adjustment is not going to be it. That is almost what the data is already shouting. So.
There's one last question. Here in Europe, you know, we have a huge debt overhead problem. People don't like to talk much about restructuring either. But one thing that we are doing through the ESM, the domestic mechanism, is transforming the debt of the Greeks or others into very long 40-year debt. What do you think of that?
So that's another, so one other thing to think about, the very big picture perspective, is don't call it default or choose the amenable name. Call it redistribution, right? What we're doing is redistribute. And in a way, at the end, after studying financial crisis with different flavors of type, that's kind of what I think is that at the end, the resolution of financial crisis, whether public or private, is redistribution. Some of it is by choice and design and careful thinking. Some of it is by how the political outcomes end up playing. So extending the maturities and doing these reconversions is redistributing the share of the contribution to regaining the stability of the fiscal accounts across agents of different cohorts and through time. Now, sometimes we think that happens because those losers haven't been born, so they can vote against this. But it's also the way it ends up working in a lot of these arrangements. So, for example, what we know from previous episodes in which this was done, this is exactly what I was referring to from Sargent and Hall, which is why his lectures are so great on this topic. It's like a mirror, right, where you're saying, when we're thinking about this extension of maturities, think about what the U.S. did when it defaulted on its debts in the years after the American War of Revolution. So it kind of sat down four groups of its debtors, and to each one of those offer a different deal. And a lot of this was a combination of extension of maturities and how soon were you going to be repaid and what denomination this stuff was going to do. And it was like a choice of a redistribution across these various groups of agents. Now, of course, it worked, but it worked in a sense because it's the second part of the Sargent story, which is his perspective on this, is that the reason that worked is because it was the sense of saying this is a social contract. We sorted out the situation today. We have to sort it out. There is some redistribution. This is what it came out of it, and that's it. The next time this happens, this isn't going to be the way to solve. And the test came when the states came back after the construction of the railroads and said, we're broke, we need money. And the federal government said, well, too bad. So that's the test, right? So you say you may be able to do this once, and then this is kind of, as I take it, although I don't think he quite says it, that he's extrapolating for Europe is what he's thinking, is if the union project grows, at some point this is a juncture where we decide which way it's going. And we do some redistribution, extensions, readjustments, bailouts, all this stuff, and we say that's it. So there has to be a credible mechanism for what that's it means.